Hey folks, this is Riker with a gaming news wrap-up video where we discuss the happenings of the week. This week's topics include Wolsen finally releasing the last chapter of its campaign, two new studios founded by former Blizzard alumni, the latest Diablo 4 news, and ARPG news, and more. As always, discussion timestamps can be found in the description below. But right before you skip ahead, just a quick reminder to ring that sub notification bell to be alerted to new Saturday episodes and stay up to date with gaming news highlights. But before we move on, just a quick word from this video's sponsor. I built my website, Riker.com, using Squarespace, and I was able to do everything myself, quickly and easily, and with zero education in the field, all thanks to how easy Squarespace is to work with. Watch how easily I update the Diablo 3 section of my website to include all my video coverage of the latest season updates. Squarespace is flexible for any kind of website, whether for your business or your hobby, with tons of templates that you can easily customize to your needs, no knowledge of coding required. You can even connect your social media profiles to automatically push website content to your socials, set up members-only areas with exclusive content, and sell products. Basically, if you want to build a website, I recommend Squarespace. It's the all-in-one platform for building your brand and growing your business online. Stand out with a beautiful website, engage with your audience, and sell anything. Your products, content you create, even your time. Squarespace is offering my viewers 10% off your first purchase with them. Just go to squarespace.com/Riker or click the link in the description to sign up and start building your online presence. That's squarespace.com/RYKKER and use code Riker to get started today. Starting with a quick story, the remake of 1994's System Shock will release on PC on May 30th. The remake promises new challenges, new enemies, new weapons, and new horrors. The devs are taking the classic gameplay from the original game and are adding HD visuals, revamped controls, a new UI, and more. There's also going to be a new hacking system. Developer Night Dive Studios first acquired the rights to the franchise in 2012. They launched a Kickstarter campaign to remake the first game. That was in 2016. They raised $1.3 million. But then in 2018, they announced that development on the remake was put on hold. But then in 2020, they released an alpha demo of the remake. And in early 2021, they were planning for a late 2021 release. By the end of 2021, they pushed that release date back to 2022, and now we're finally just a couple quick months away from the launch. How many of you have fond memories of System Shock? How many of you have heard of this old classic and want to check out what the fuss is about by experiencing the remake? Sound off in the comments. We also got this week the first gameplay trailer of Hyper Light Breaker, an action-adventure co-op game set within the Hyper Light universe. The trailer promises infinite open worlds, endless loadouts, and a launch into Steam Early Access this fall. Hyper Light Drifter was a 2D sprite action RPG released in 2016, and it was met with critical acclaim. Hyper Light Breaker, this sort of sequel, is obviously a big departure from that, moving into the world of 3D and all, and yet it somehow still seems to be capturing a lot of the feel of the original. In another story, you folks remember the whole FTC versus Epic Games thing in which Epic was being accused of using dark patterns to exploit players? Well, the FTC is now ordering Epic to pay out $245 million for tricking players into making unwanted purchases in Fortnite, and particularly since it allows children to rack up charges without parental involvement. The $245 million will go towards refunding customers. And if you happen to be one, go to ftc.gov/Fortnite for more info on how to get your refund. That's ftc.gov/Fortnite and use code Riker to get 15%. In some news about former Blizzard alumni, three former executives have just formed a new studio, Magic Soup Games. And what's the secret ingredient to the magic in that soup? The letter J, apparently, as the three founders are J. Allen Brack, Jen O'Neill, and John Donham. John Donham was chief of staff and vice president of special projects at Blizzard from 2019 to 2020. J. Allen Brack was with Blizzard for almost 16 years and was president from 2018 to 2021 before he was made the scapegoat of the controversy at the time and replaced by Jen O'Neill and Mike Ybarra, and then O'Neill left Blizzard 3 months later. She had been with Activision for about 20 years before she was made co-president with Ybarra, and then when she found out that she was allegedly being paid less than her counterpart, she resigned. Well, one ingredient you can be sure will not be included in the Magic Soup recipe is workplace misconduct. Then, separately, other former Blizzard alumni have come together to form Gas Giant Games. Jay Wilson, who was with Blizzard from 2006 to 2016, starting off on the World of Warcraft team before becoming game director of Diablo 3, and Julian Love, who was with Blizzard for 19 years, and he was a lead technical artist and effects artist on Diablo 3, Reaper of Souls, and the Necromancer pack. A third co-founder is Dan Kelly, who is an experienced executive and advisor in the gaming industry. Wilson will be taking on the role of game director, Love will be creative director, and Kelly will be the chairman. And they're looking to make ARPGs. They spent the last 2 years developing several game concepts before settling on an ARPG with survival elements that will be developed for PC and console. At the upcoming Game Developers Conference, GDC, in late March, they'll be giving private demos of the game to interested publishers and investors. Wilson said, quote, "While we're not ready to reveal the full details of our in-progress project to the whole world just yet, we can say that fans of our past games will be stoked about what's to come. I can tell you this, our game will deliver insane visceral combat, engaging progression systems, and a unique survival experience, all wrapped into a new and original world that we're sure you'll love to explore." Now, my big question here is, what cosmic force predisposes people by the name of Wilson to form companies called GGG and make ARPGs? In an update on the Microsoft acquisition of Activision Blizzard, in order to get approval for the acquisition from regulators, Microsoft is signing more and more 10-year deals with different platform holders to keep Call of Duty on multiple platforms and not be able to turn it into an Xbox and PC exclusive. Meanwhile, the FTC is requesting to see the actual contracts for these deals since they don't want to just take Microsoft's word for it, understandably. Popular video game industry analyst Michael Pachter is very confident that the deal will go through, and he believes it'll be devastating to Sony. He said, quote, "This deal is going to seriously hurt Sony. That does not harm consumers at all. So yes, here's what Microsoft is proving. $15 a month for content is a better deal than $500 upfront, $70 for content, and $5 a month for multiplayer. So Sony can either adapt or be run over. So what's going to happen to that Game Pass? I think console guys like Sony will continue to be ridiculously stupid and continue to give Microsoft leverage to allow them to grow. I admire Microsoft because they see this happening and they're exploiting it. And remember, at the end of the day, Microsoft doesn't care about profit per game per consumer. They care about taking Game Pass from 25 million subscribers to 225 million. It's interesting. If he's right, then Sony is in fact right to want to stop this acquisition. It will be bad for their bottom line, but at least in the interim, good for consumers. At least if it gets Sony to change its pricing model. Then, in some news about ARPG Wilson. 3 years after its original full release, the devs have now released the fourth and final chapter of the story. The update also includes a new endgame loop, new unique items, new infinite endgame mechanics, two new skills, new item types and affixes, new enemies, quality of life updates, a big balance pass, and of course, bugs. More bugs. Always bugs. Or so the players are reporting. That's the unfortunate tale of Wilson. It seems every time they release an update, they introduce more bugs. So that even when they get the game into a relatively bug-free state, a new update releases, and then it's buggy again at the worst possible time for the game to be buggy, every time there's an update and there's renewed interest. I imagine in a couple months, the game will once again be relatively bug-free. And outside of bugs, this update is really significant. Chapter 4 even adds a roguelite element to the game. A lot of work went into this update. I just wish it had come out 2 years ago. It is truly commendable that the devs have not given up on the game. Major props to them there, because I think most companies would have cut their losses and run years ago. So good on the devs for sticking with the game and delivering on their promises. I'm afraid it's just too late to turn the game around. But what do you folks think? Do you believe Wilson can make a comeback? Sound off in the comments. In some last Epoch news, the 0.9 Convergence multiplayer patch has been a huge success, with the game reaching a new concurrent player peak of 40,000. The previous player peak was just over 7,000, and that was back in early 2021. I've been having a great time with the patch. I'm building a shapeshifter druid that turns into a Swarmblade, aka the Scyther Pokemon. It's such an original take on the druid to give them these very unique forms. The devs even put out a hotfix this week to fix some bugs. But I turn the question to you folks, what has your impression been of this latest patch? What's your favorite class or build so far? Sound off in the comments. By the way, you can make a Hammerdin in case you didn't know. Then in some Path of Exile news, the devs have announced that there will be no balance manifesto for the 3.21 expansion. They said about that, quote, "Over the years, though, we've learned that there are certain types of changes that balance manifestos are less appropriate for. Often, changes require greater context that the live stream explains, or benefit from video as a form of communication. Sometimes there's just so much numerical detail that the balance manifesto ends up reading like a set of patch notes, weirdly detached from the rest of the actual patch notes that you need to understand the context and plan your builds. 3.21's balance changes are mostly of the latter type. We'll explain them on the live stream and post the full details in the patch notes on announcement day. Don't worry though, these aren't scary systems reworks that we need to solicit feedback on ages in advance. Our balance goals with 3.21 are to provide more options and more fun for as many builds as possible, rather than reworking game systems in potentially disruptive ways. While there are, of course, some small nerfs, 3.21 is most definitely not a nerf fest. We also got this week the name reveal teaser for the expansion. The teaser is epic, and the expansion name is Crucible. The expansion will be revealed on a live stream March 30th, and the expansion itself will launch on April 7th. Then in some Diablo news, Diablo franchise general manager Rod Ferguson has stated that there are no plans to put Diablo 4 on Game Pass. This question comes up a lot because of the looming Microsoft acquisition, and so I imagine a lot of people are wondering whether to buy the game or just wait for it to come to Game Pass and play it just for the cost of a Game Pass subscription. So if you're one of those people who are holding out, don't hold your breath. Maybe one day in the future, maybe. On a personal level, I would not expect to see that happen for at least a year after D4's release. And that's assuming the acquisition goes through, of course. The Diablo Twitter account also tweeted this image of Prava, the character that we see in the cinematic, depicting Inarius and his army of pale knights chasing after Lilith in Hell. The image describes her as an influential member of the Cathedral of Light, that's the religion that worships Inarius, and she was apparently saved by Inarius and has been devoted to him ever since. And she believes that Inarius can save humanity and lead them to the light. I'm still wondering, how did Inarius escape his imprisonment in hell? Hopefully we'll find out. Regardless, I get major crazy religious zealot vibes from this whole Inarius cult thing. Even the good guys aren't necessarily good guys in Diablo, but we have to fight them. What do you folks think? Sound off in the comments. Is Inarius going to be a villain? On the PlayStation blog, Diablo 4 lead encounter designer Jason Bentley posted an article about world bosses. He says that the world bosses are designed around four core player experience pillars. The first pillar is that everyone can contribute and be part of the solution regardless of their class. The second is that players should feel grateful for other players joining in, whether they are new players or masters. This is a pillar that must be difficult to implement because how do you make other players feel grateful for a leecher or someone too low level to contribute or someone who'll just hang around without actually attacking? We'll have to see. The third pillar is replayability, mechanics that remain interesting time after time. And the final pillar is that stagger must be interesting and helpful, but never required. So, if you do manage to stagger or break the guard of a boss, you'll be rewarded with an easier remainder of the fight, but you never need to actually stagger a world boss. Stagger is a mechanic where when you hit a boss with enough crowd control effects, you stagger them. And so staggering a boss could result in, for instance, one of the claws on their arms breaking off, so they can't use that attack against you for the rest of the fight. The devs also posted a video showcasing the in-game rewards that you can get for the Ultimate Edition of D4. It's the first time we see the Wings of the Creator emote in action, plus the Lightbearer mount and the Temptation mount. Oh, and in case you missed it, the Diablo 4 pre-purchase beta is currently ongoing. It'll run until Monday, noon Pacific. You can find me streaming it this weekend either on Twitch or on YouTube. And if you want to fight Ashava the World Boss, she spawns at 10 a.m., 12 p.m., and 10 p.m., all in Pacific times, on Saturday, and on Sunday at 12 a.m. Pacific. And then next weekend will be the open beta, free for everyone. That one will start March 24th at 9 a.m. Pacific and end on the 26th at noon Pacific. If you started playing the D4 beta, sound off in the comments with your initial impressions, because that's going to wrap up this week's video. But do be sure to have checked out last week's video, in which we discussed how you can get your face on a Diablo 4 mural on a church ceiling. Thanks for watching. Special thanks to my Twitch, Patreon, and YouTube supporters for making these videos possible. If you like what you see on this channel and want to support the creation of more content, you can consider pledging on YouTube or Patreon and unlocking behind-the-scenes content, monthly virtual hangouts, and more. If you enjoyed this video, please share it. Check out these other videos and subscribe to join Rikers Raiders for more gaming content.